They operate in strictest secrecy at the cutting edge of Australia's defence. They're creative, unorthodox, and comfortable in chaos. For over 50 years, the Australian SAS has put their lives at risk deep in enemy territory. This is the only television history ever supported by this highly secretive regiment. We take you beyond the stereotypes to reveal the unexpected story of the real people who transformed SAS from the ugly duckling of the Australian Army into pride of place as Australia's force of first choice. We take you on a journey through the history of SAS operations in both war and peace, starting with the rise of special forces in World War II. We penetrate the philosophy of the fearful SAS selection course and follow SAS into the savage jungles of Borneo and Vietnam. In response to the rise of global terrorism and asymmetric warfare, we'll see SAS reinvent itself as Australia's crack counter-terrorist force. Its versatility flourishes in third world operations in Timor and Africa. It weathers the Black Hawk disaster and the Tampa crisis. In the recent operations in Iraq and Afghanistan, SAS has excelled itself. Using rare archival and amateur vision, we examine the unusual, unorthodox military culture of SAS, a culture that relishes change and has continually reinvented itself to survive. We examine how SAS soldiers think and what makes them so successful.
And during survival course, you're taught to catch a cobra, how to cook a tarantula and a scorpion.
We were taken to 10,000 feet and just thrown out and to sort ourselves out quick smart. The sky, the ground, the sky, the ground, the sky, the ground, and you just tumbled.
We would help them with their health problems, and we had some really significant results there. Perhaps help deliver children, try and do something about the hygiene in the village, which was pretty ghastly.
We were not afraid of the American GIs, Australian infantry, or South Vietnamese troops, but we hated the Australian SAS Rangers, because they make comrades disappear very suddenly.
Now, people need to remember that the 1970s was a period awash with terrorism. The Red Brigades, the PLO, the PLFP.
Probably within 5 to 6 metres, be able to put two rounds in rapid pace, basically within an inch of each other. That was expected.
I knew that General Mattis wanted us to physically and psychologically dislocate the Taliban in the south.
And she was just sitting there with blood dripping and not saying a word. We had no idea where to start. Everybody had horrific injuries like this, and there were hundreds.
Kept pushing. We didn't want to destroy any of the civilian infrastructure because, again, the whole aim of this was to get Iraq back on its feet very quickly as an upstanding, you know, member of the global community. An example was the thing that I termed as the Temple of Doom. We came up with a plan of breaking the sound barrier above the two cement silos. It came down very low, very fast, straight over the cement factory, but didn't break the sound barrier. And he got on the radio and said, "How was that?" And I said, "That was excellent, mate. It was fantastic, but you didn't break the sound barrier." And he was absolutely devastated. And he asked me again if he could have another go. I said, "Sure, have another go." And he came back around. It was a thunderous crack. And it was done right over the top of the cement conning towers or the cement silos. We were able to disarm all the guards.
During the battle, it became apparent that a lot of the B-52 strikes were wasted on probably missions that didn't need to be conducted. So we requested through the chaos that we get control of the B-52s, which we did, and had airstrikes conducted in an area where I thought the enemy would be affected to a greater extent.
Our team leader, Matt, had incredible tactical cunning. Matt began to have an aha moment. He all of a sudden began to realize and shape the picture of the battle space through the enemy's eyes. He began to realize that if I was the enemy, this is where I would be reinforcing, this is where I would have my mortar positions, this is how I would run my supply line. I was able to task the Predator to look at those areas. And as the Predator was moving around and looking at those areas, lo and behold, there was the enemy. The mortar positions were tents, they were trucks carrying ammunition, they were encampments of the enemy, and most of these were along creek beds.
When the gunships checked in at night, inevitably they would find something there, report back to us what they see. We would give them a clear hot, which means that they could engage.
We utilized the A-10s. There was two A-10s. And then as the Predator would find a new target, I'd roll the A-10 on that target, and the gunship would continue firing on that one. And then the Predator would find another target, and then I would move the C-130, the AC-130, to that target. We leapfrogged.
Many nights we had four gunships, you know, back to back. One would turn up full and go home, and the Americans call it Winchester. When they're Winchester, they've run out of all ammunition. So they would check in full and go home Winchester, four of them in a night, and that happened for a lot of nights.